Welcome, friends, to this afternoon session of our second day of the meditation workshop in Menominee, Wisconsin. Very happy to welcome you again. As I said yesterday and today, I'll use this time with you to answer your questions that have come from you. So if Jonathan will read the questions, and I may reread them before answering, so I'm going to use my little reading glasses. They look so small. These big glasses can fit into such a small case, why can't all of us fit into our third eye center? Yes, Jonathan.
I would like to know if there is only one tenth door or if there are many, one for each creature in existence.
I would like to know if there's only one tenth door or if there are many, one for each creature in existence. There is one tenth door for each creature in existence. And the tenth door is referred to the door that opens up beyond the nine doors. The nine doors are the doors of our contacts with the world, and they are referred to as the two eyes, the two ears, the two nostrils, the mouth, the two lower apertures. These nine doors have been referred to, and the inside door is considered tenth door. That is for everybody. We have a tenth door to open, and we open the tenth door when we concentrate our attention on the third eye center. Another tenth door has been referred to, which is beyond the mind. That also is a real door that opens up even beyond all doors. And that tenth door is opened with the love and devotion which we can give to the Master. So the references in the literature are to two tenth doors. One is tenth door beyond these nine doors on the physical body, and the second tenth door is beyond the mind.
I am still confused about how to meditate on the self. If the self meditates on the self, that implies two selves, but there is only one self.
I am still confused about how to meditate on the self. If the self meditates on the self, that indicates two selves, but there is only one self. We have got too many selves, that's the problem. Not two, so many. Our body is our self, our sense perceptions are our self. Our mind is ourself, our soul is ourself, our totality is ourself, our higher self is ourself. We are talking of so many selves all the time. There is only one self. The experiencer at all times is only one. You never had two experiences. The experiencer alone is the self, not the experience. Remember this. When we are looking for the self, we are looking for the experiencer and not the experience. We are so used to looking for experiences that we forget that the self is experiencer. We have to realize our own self, not find something other than ourself. The withdrawal of attention is opposed to the focusing of attention exactly in this way. When we focus attention, we create another self. When we withdraw attention, it is to only one self. If you notice, no matter whether we are dreaming, whether we are awake, whether we are in a higher state of consciousness or in totality, there's only one self operating at any time. All others that we watch are part of the experience. Only one self at any time, working at any level. So that is why there are no two selves. We are making so many selves by misidentifying ourselves with our bodies, with our perceptions, with our contacts with people. We are just making up all this, only one self.
As a spiritual aspirant, how do we experience process sympathy, empathy, and compassion without being overcome by emotion?
As a spiritual aspirant, how do we experience, process sympathy, empathy, and compassion without being overcome by emotion? Emotions are a function of the energy centers. When you are emotional, you're not calm. People say, be cool. When they say, be cool, they're referring to your coolness at the Agni chakra. That means the eye center, not in the heart center. Emotions operate from the heart center, are a part of the pattern of energies. Therefore, if you get emotional, it's part of the energy centers operating. Nothing wrong with it. These six centers of energies that are lying below the eyes, they are all operating all the time to sustain us. To sustain us, to be in contact with the world, to live in the world, and to live by ourselves, all these six centers are necessary. They are all in operation at all the time. Emotions are a natural result. But the emotions can come along with other features that you have. For example, you love somebody, you have compassion for somebody, emotion can also come. There's no contradiction in the two. You handle them by continuing to follow the compassion part, love part. If you meditate regularly, you will find it's very easy to remain cool even in the midst of all the emotions that you have. So that is why meditation is the answer to how to handle your emotions. Compassion is a follow-up from love. When you love somebody, compassion comes automatically. It's very different from emotion. Compassion is very cool. Emotions are hot. Emotions make you cry. Emotions make you feel different. Emotions lower your attention to the heart center. Whereas compassion and love keeps you at the higher center, keeps you cool.
How can meditation help with financial problems?
How can meditation help you with financial problems? If you meditate regularly, what you have will be enough. Otherwise, it will always be less.
What should I do if my kids and family members, who are your initiates, do not want to attend your satsangs, but instead want to go out sightseeing or playing in every place?
What should I do if my kids, family members, who are your initiates, do not want to attend your satsang, but instead want to go out sightseeing or playing in every place? Let them play in every place. What is your problem? You attend to your satsang, let them go where they want. You are not responsible for everybody else. The spiritual path is a one-on-one relationship with the Master. Yeah. It is not a family relationship. It's not a societal relationship. It's not even a crowd relationship. It's one-on-one. Therefore, you take care of yourself, they will take care of themselves. What we do in life is all dictated by our pattern of karma, the actions we have performed in past lives, the people we meet, the playfulness we do, the things we do, every relationship we have is all based on previous karmas, previous actions, previous intentions of ours in past lives or even in the earlier part of this life. They will play out anyway, and you should accept it. When children grow up, we are worried about them. That's part of their karma, and it's our part of our karma to be worried about them. The five vices, they call, are not really as vicious as we think. If we did not have the five vices, we would not be able to pay off any karma of ours. That is why there's a place for them also. But when we are on a spiritual path, we control them for ourselves, not for anybody else. So remember that you are responsible for yourself and not others. And don't be judgmental. When you say, why is he not attending satsang? and playing outside, you are being judgmental. Don't judge, it's not necessary. Being judgmental does not help us. It only adds to our own karma. So that is why, let them do what they like, you remain on the path, on track.
We have heard you say that when someone criticizes you, that it actually helps you. How does that work?
We have heard you say that when someone criticizes you, it actually helps you. How does that work? If somebody criticizes you and you respond, he is criticizing you as part of his karma. If you respond, it becomes your karma. If you do not respond, you are ending an earlier karma by which he came to criticize you. That is why it actually helps you to smile. Somebody criticizes you, you smile. If he criticizes you more, smile more. And if he argues too much, then follow. A tip one Swami gave. A Swami was talking in Chicago, and I heard his talk. He mentioned that there was once a guru talking to people. Suddenly, an American disciple got up. A lady got up and said, "Master, we have a big problem. I and my husband are arguing all the time. Is there any solution for that?" He said, "Yes, there is a solution. You bring a bottle of water. I will bless it. And that will take care of it." So she brought the bottle of water and he blessed it. Maybe he said some mantras and he waved his hands over it and it gave her the blessed water. She said, "How often should I give it to my husband?" He said, "Not for your husband. It's for you, but I'll tell you how to use it. When your husband starts arguing, you take the bottle, take one sip of the water and hold it in your mouth. Don't swallow. When he stops, then you swallow. If he starts speaking again, take another sip. You will have no problem ever." You all like that one, huh? You can bring a bottle of water to me whenever you like.
Since our life is a DVD, predetermined destiny, how can we have intuition? Is it part of the DVD as well, since we are not having free will? Please explain intuition in context of DVD.
Since our life is a DVD, predetermined destiny, how come we have intuition? Is it part of DVD as well, since we are not having free will? Please explain intuition in context of DVD. Well, if you have understood intuition as a spiritual function of the soul, it's not part of the mind. Therefore, when we have the intuition, we are directly dealing with something which takes into account all our past. When we deal with the mind, with our thinking, we deal with a very small spectrum of data available to us. Therefore, intuition works well in decision-making. We are using both soul and mind in our decision-making. Intuitive decision-making is from the soul. Thoughtful, reasoned decision-making from the mind. So far as DVD is concerned, everything is written there, including use of intuition, including use of mind.
When I like someone, how do I know if it is my mind that likes them or my soul?
I'm liking the usage of my glasses. I don't normally use them. It's more for show. When I like someone, how do I know if it is my mind who's liking or my soul? Let me first tell you that the difference between the mind and the soul is very fundamental. This mind functions in time, always. Every thought has a duration. You cannot think without time. So thinking and mind are always a duration. Intuition and soul is never in mind, never in time. They're spontaneous. When you have a spontaneous experience, whether with somebody or otherwise, it's intuitive. It is soul. When you have experience which takes time to know or to experience it, it is mind. So mind and soul, the distinction is the mind always functions in time and the soul does not. That is why we say when you have an intuition, it's spontaneous. It does not take any minutes or seconds. Mind for the smallest thought takes time. When you suddenly see the beauty of flowers, it's instantaneous. When you try to analyze, it's the mind. The difference is that the mind uses time, intuition and soul do not.
We have heard cases where patients come out of a coma after tens of years. Following from this, can a soul exist in a cryogenic body after, say, 100 years?
We have heard cases where patients came out of a coma after tens of years. Following from this, can a soul exist in a cryogenic body after, say, 100 years? A soul can stay in the body in that state forever. Soul has no limit. Therefore, so long as the body is holding life in any form, it's there. If the body is not holding life, it's gone. It's whether the life is still there. If you say a person has a near-death experience, it's never called death experience, a near-death experience. The experience of the individual who's having near-death experience is a failure of the organs of the body, yet ability to return, so the soul is still there. Soul has never left. When you are dead completely, then only soul goes. So that is why in any form where you can maintain a body, but no matter how long, the soul is there.
There are some people that are blessed and get to be with you more easily than others. Is it because of their good karma? Are they more lucky than me?
There are some people that are blessed and get to be with you more easily than others. Is it because of their good karma? Are they more lucky than me? Not really. I'll tell you an incident. When I was working with the government, I had an attendant, a servant, who used to carry my bags and carry me to the car, drive the car, things like that. He was my assistant. And very often he accompanied me to the satsangs of masters. And when we went to satsang of one master, he says, "Is he a genuine master?" I said, "Why?" He says, "Because I notice that people who are rich, who are influential, the politicians, they get close to him, they can see him when they want, and we poor people sit at the back of the audience and are almost ignored by him. So that is not fair. If he is a master, he should be equally kind to everybody and not give special favor to those who are close to him." I said, "Let's go to the master and ask him what's the answer." So I took him to the master. I said, "This friend of mine who works for me has a serious problem. That why are you giving importance to these rich people, famous people, these VIPs who come specially? You've made arrangements for them to see you easily. And the others, like us poor people, are sitting at the back." Master said, "Did you ever watch me in the satsang where I see when I'm giving a discourse? I am looking at the back, not those sitting in front. Drishti is a very important thing, and people at the back are getting a drishti. The ones coming very close don't get it." The same thing was once explained by great master when he said, because we were using the small candles, he said a candle, a little light, in a diva they call it, there is always darkness around it. The light falls further away from very close to it. He says, so do not believe that just because a person is physically close to a master, he is getting something more than you are getting. So therefore, you are equally blessed. I can tell you that people who are very far away can hardly ever come to the master, sometimes are more blessed than people who think they are very close. It's not the physical presence at all. It's something else. It's the feeling of love and devotion. The devotion you feel, the love of the master you feel, which you can feel anywhere. People who are sometimes very close to a master, I've seen that even in great master's time, they see so much of his human side that sometimes they forget he's a master. Because masters are ordinary human beings, they have an ordinary human life. But when we see masters rarely and from a distance, we see the spiritual side of them. And the human side is only marginal. But for those who are very close, they see the human being, they can even discuss with master. I have seen people, master, that's not the best way you give satsang. I was surprised. Advisors sitting around master, telling them what you should do. Master says, I'm sorry, I'll try to do better next time. So that is why you are blessed no matter where you are.
When I meditate, I was able to fly like you instructed, but I was looking at myself flying. So I jumped in the astral body, but I would keep coming out and observe myself flying. Any tips?
When I meditate, I was able to fly like you instructed, but I was looking at myself flying, and so I jumped in the astral body, but I would keep coming out and observe myself flying. This happens. This happens when we are flying without full withdrawal of awareness from the body. So we actually are creating another form of ours. It's flying. Most of the time when we do that, sometimes the feeling is I am flying. Sometimes the feeling is I am seeing someone flying. And this sometimes varies. It's only the beginning. If you practice this, you'll find you will be flying all the time and not watching who you fly.
Is getting to the station having your attention on third eye center or the 10th door open and through?
Is getting to the station having your attention on third eye center or the 10th door open and through? I suppose it's very open and through. I don't see any obstacle except our attention not really focusing or going within, but focusing on things outside. Instead of withdrawing attention, the attention is always going outside. That's the only obstacle really. To think of it, what is the obstacle between us and our own self, our own truth? If you examine carefully, the only obstacle between ourselves and realization of ourselves is our own mind. It's the mind that is using attention to go outside and not stay inside. So that is why it is very open and through, except for the obstacle created by the mind. People have said, can we control our mind? I mentioned how a person said he can stop thinking. I gave you an example. One master said, if somebody comes and tells me that he has moved the whole Himalayan mountain in his hand, I know it's impossible. For one moment, I might accept it. Such a human being can be created. Who can do that? If somebody says, I've drunk the water of all the oceans and the seas, impossible. But for a moment, I can believe it. But if somebody comes and tells me, I've controlled my mind, I'll say, never, never, never. That's how the masters have expressed the difficulty of controlling the mind. So many people write to me, when we meditate, our mind does not let us meditate. Our mind is constantly thinking of other things. Which is true. That's the obstacle we have. Otherwise, the path is very true. You just withdraw and go. The path is very simple. We have made it difficult because of our attachments, our desire, our use of the mind for so many lifetimes. And that's why we got into that strange practice of using the mind always outside. Now, when the mind takes us outside, how do we handle it? We can't stop it. Do we fight with it? Some people say we should fight with the mind. I've tried that. I used to fight with the mind in my early stages of meditation. I would try to focus attention inside, mind would think of something else, I said, shut up, let me meditate. Then the mind would take me somewhere else. I would say, no more, let me meditate. Let me stay in the third eye center. Mind would take me somewhere else. And this went on, 2.5 hours of meditation. I was exhausted. Got nothing out of meditation. I said, what is this? I was fighting the mind and winning every battle, and yet lost the war. You win the battle with fighting with the mind, but you lose the war. Mind is very happy to keep you in that battle. It's a good way to distract you. So that is why that system of trying to fight the mind never worked. I went back to Great Master and explained to him this problem of mine. And he told me, fighting the mind is not easy. There is another way of doing it. And he said, ignore the mind. Don't fight. Ignore the mind. Mind thinks, let it think. You stay focused. Separate yourself. When we do the exercise which I was mentioning, to separate yourself from the mind, to watch the mind, if you do that exercise sufficiently in many times over, you realize you can always separate yourself from the mind and let it think like it was thinking the other day when you tried the short experiment. So you can ignore the mind, you can go on doing, don't put any attention on the mind, put attention on the soul, put attention on the sound, put attention on yourself. Put attention on your master who is representing you. Put attention on the memory of your master. Put attention on that, and you will at the same time see mind is going on saying things. Ignore it. That is possible. For me, that worked. You can try it also.
In what ways does a person die on the inner planes? Is there violence there as well?
In what ways does a person die in the inner planes? What's the second word?
Violence. Is there violence?
Yeah, yeah, my glass is not too good. I better use the regular ones. Is there violence there as well? Well, dying is in different ways. When we die in the physical body, we can die a natural death. They call it natural death. Old age, illnesses that come in old age, something fail, organs fail, and the soul says that has left the body, only flesh is left there. That's one way of dying. Second way of dying is can be violent death. Somebody murders you, or you commit suicide. So you have ended your life differently than the natural way. Were you supposed to live to that natural life or not? According to the law of karma, your life is based upon the natural way of dying, not violent way of dying. When you die violently, the remaining part of your notional life, your astral self, dying is merely the separation of astral self, your astral self is still there to continue the remaining part of your notional life. Supposing somebody's notional life is 80 years. At age 50, he dies of murder. 30 years more, the astral self will be here, not reincarnate or not go anywhere else. So that is why violent deaths that take place here are not actually the death as it is normal. Normally, when the death takes place, one can go anywhere, reincarnate almost immediately, for which a body might already be being prepared. Because when a person dies and has to reincarnate as a human being, the person will be walking here and the mother-to-be may be carrying a baby. It's in the 5th month of pregnancy when the quickening takes place and the mother feels the baby moving in the womb, that the soul of that person actually enters and makes a separate living being. Before that, it's part of the mother. It's just a fetus. It's a big part of the mother. So it can happen. Person is walking, woman is pregnant, same very person is going to be born there. So these birth and death are merely the movement of the astral self into a physical body and leaving the physical body. So violent deaths are taking place here, but in the inner self, there is no violent death of this kind. Only when you have completed your term, which is the astral self, is between 1,000 and 3,000 years of physical time, the body passes naturally. The astral self passes naturally and the causal self comes out. The causal self remains intact for millions of years. The causal self is our mind. The mind we are holding right now in our head, the mind that is using the brain to think, that mind has a very long life. That is why when the same mind is there in the astral body, the same mind can remember things that happened way before the body was born. People can recollect past lives. Sometimes they can remember it even now, because the astral self, the causal self, and the physical self all overlap right now. They're all functioning together. They're not separate somewhere. So they all function. The sensory perceptions we are using in the physical body is coming from the astral self. The thoughts we are using, rationality we are using, is coming from the causal self. And the life that we have, the consciousness we have, is coming from the soul. All these work together. So there is violent death and premature death taking place in the physical plane. But because the knowledge is much more in the other plane, that is why this violence does not take place there. But the death is always a natural time.
Can we control our awareness with free will? Can we concentrate it where we want, or are there restrictions? Do we have free will, and if yes, to what extent?
Can we control our awareness with free will? Can we concentrate it if we want, or are there other restrictions? Do we have free will, and if yes, to what extent? It's a big subject of free will, but I can tell you very briefly. Free will is an experience, a necessary experience for seeking. Therefore, it's a unique gift given to human beings to have free will, to feel they can seek, they can look for what they want. Therefore, it's an actual experience. It's not something that we are making up that, oh, I have free will, but I really don't have free will. Except when a guy says, I am helpless, he has no free will. If you are not saying that, you have free will. When we make decisions on awareness, we are making with the same free will. When we decide to sit for meditation, we are doing it with free will. When we decide not to sit for meditation, go to play, we are doing it with free will. We are using free will all the time. And that is why, I don't know if I told you the story of another friend of mine, who also when I was studying at Cambridge, at Harvard, he was also a student there, philosophy. He was studying philosophy with some interesting professors, psychology professors. And he called me one morning. He said, Eureka, I found out we have no free will. And I said, how did you find out? He said, I found out on the basis of religion, religious belief. Religion says that God, the creator, is omnipresent, omnipotent, that means present everywhere, all-powerful, and omniscient. He knows everything. If God knows everything, and we are trying to decide something, does he know what we are going to decide? If he doesn't know, he's not omniscient. And if he knows, we have no free will. Very simple way to find out. That if we believe in God, an omniscient God, a God who knows everything, then he must know what we are going to decide. If he doesn't, he's not God, the one we are defining by omniscience. That is why he said, I found out. I said, will you please come to my apartment? I'll discuss this further with you. Yeah, whether you said you found, there's no free will. Okay. When he came, I tried a little trick on him. I prepared a tray with a cup of coffee and a cup of tea and an empty cup. When he came, I said, "My friend, would you like coffee or tea or nothing? I've got all three here. And don't use your free will, you don't have any." He said, "What have you done to me?" I said, "I'm proving that you can't help having free will. If you say coffee, you've just used free will. If you say tea, you have used free will. If you say nothing, you use free will. If you say don't want to answer, you have used free will. Escape from free will now. You said there is no free will, and I'm proving to you I have free will. You have actual free will all the time. Every day you use free will. Therefore, the experience of free will is real, and we cannot avoid it." Now, was it real? I said, "You might have heard in spiritual talks, people say there's no real free will. It's just an illusion that we feel free will. Really, everything is predetermined. The two things don't make sense to us while we are using free will. Maybe they will make sense when we go to where already everything is predetermined, the causal plane. Right now, it doesn't make sense to us. I am not going to use that argument. I am going to use a scientific argument, an actual scientific proven thing, that when I offered you tea, coffee, or nothing, your mind was thinking what to take, coffee or tea or nothing. Now, when your mind contemplates the use of free will, what are the factors in the mind, known or unknown to you, which are helping you to decide? Only two sets of factors. One, hereditary, your DNA. Your father was drinking coffee, grandfather was drinking coffee, is gone into you, and therefore the tendency to prefer coffee is coming from your genes. Or there can be a second reason. You have spent time with coffee drinkers, and therefore you acquired a taste for coffee. Do you realize at the time when I offered you tea and coffee, both those factors, where you have been associating with people and where you were born, is already fixed. Therefore, the factors that affected you to make your choice were already fixed, scientifically. Therefore, you had no choice but to make the only reason why you thought you had free will is because you're neither aware of your hereditary genes, what they're carrying, nor are you aware to remember all the acquisition of tendency that you acquired by the company. Therefore, scientifically also, we are only acting on these factors. There's no third factor at all. So that is why those factors, every time we make a decision, both are fixed. They're already gone. You can't change them. That is why free will is merely an experience, because we are not aware of the totality. If we could be aware of all our past, if we could be aware of all our ancestry, we would right here physically know why we are choosing coffee, why we are choosing tea, why we are taking that decision. All decisions that we make are based on these two factors. So that is why free will is an experience when we are ignorant. So, and the other ignorance is, we don't know what will happen the next 5 minutes, what will happen next year. We have no idea. We just think it will happen like that. Things don't always turn out like that. Ignorance of the future establishes the reality of free will. Free will is real so far as we are ignorant. Then we get the knowledge, free will disappears. Then we know how the pattern of free will has been established, how it is set up. I'll tell you, I might have told you earlier a story. I once went for an interview for the Indian Navy when I was working in India. And after I came from the interview, there was a man with a turban standing, saying, "Good luck to me, good luck." So I said, "Why are you talking in English? We are Indian people sitting here." He said, "I have some good luck for you. I'll tell you something." So he told me some things. Then he said, "Okay, do you have a piece of paper?" I said, "Yes." I took out a piece of paper. He said, "Give me the pen also." So he looked at my eyes, and began to write on it. He was writing, looking at me, writing something. I said, don't know what he's writing. Then after that little piece of paper, he folded it like this, then he folded it like this, then he further folded it like this, and gave it in my hand. He said, hold this in your hand. Now take out another piece of paper and write the answer to my questions. First question, write a number between 1 and 10. I said, this is a very old trick. I thought to myself, yes, children we used to play. Tell me a number, I'll guess it. I'll write a number 5. Between 1 and 10, they say 5. I said, this chap is thinking, I am going to write 5. I am going to call his bluff off. So I wrote 3. He said, write the name of a flower. I said, he's expecting me to write the most common name, Rose. I am not going to write that. This interview was taking place in Lucknow, away from my own state of Punjab. I said, I'll write the name of a flower he may not have heard of. So I wrote Chameli, C-H-A-M-E-L-I in capitals. And then he said, write your date of birth. I wrote 1926. He looked at me, this is not your date of birth, this is your year of birth. Write your date. So in India, we always write the date before the year. So then I added after that, November 26th. And he said, now open the paper I gave you. So I opened the paper he had given me, which was in my hand. And when I opened it, it said very clearly, 3, Chameli, 1926, and then the date, exactly as I had it. I was completely stunned. How could he write before I even thought about the numbers? How is it possible? I said, please tell me how you do it. He said, we are a small group of people called Bhatras. We are Bhatras, and we have been trained by a guru to read the minds of people as it will be next 5 minutes. Not what is happening now. What will happen in their mind in the next 10 minutes, we have learned that. It's a very special kind of meditation we do that jumps ahead into the future and picks up 5 minutes of knowledge of a person. And I am one of those people, I used it. So what struck me was, how could he know what I am going to use with my free will for? I use my free will. I even debated. While I was thinking like this, he said, shall I tell you more? I said, please go ahead. He said, when I asked you to write a number between 1 and 10, you said, he is thinking I will write 5. I will call off his bluff and I will write 3. He told me my exact thought. When I said, write a name of flower, you said, I'll write a name of a flower he may not have heard of. He repeated my thought. And this was so amazing for me that he not only told me what I would think of later, he told me a whole thought process. That was a big experience. Since I narrated this experience in some of my talks, I have heard from many people around the world having similar experiences from similar Bhatras, who are some, very few people are left like that, but they have a meditation technique just to see a future. Proving clearly that what we think we are doing with free will is pre-written. But we feel it's free will because we don't know what the future is. That is why ignorance is creating this experience. So that is why we use free will, which is an experience for us, to meditate, to go up to the third level. After that, free will stops. The mind is not using free will. And the pull of love of a master pulls us up.
Is it possible for the inner master to take our soul back to Sat Chit Kan during our meditation?
Is it possible for the inner master to take me to Sat Chit Kan during meditation? Yes. Masters, they're little clever people, I must tell you. They can give us glimpses of many kinds. And it's very interesting. We get initiated by a master. He gives us a glimpse, orange sky, glimpse, oneness, Sat Chit Kan. We can't even describe what happens to us. absolutely 100% convinced he's a perfect master. And what he says is really true. He just had an experience. And then we meditate and meditate for years and it never happens again. We wonder what happened. Something we got so quickly in the beginning and it doesn't come again. You go to master, master, I've been meditating so much that day. One, on the first month I got all this and what's happening? Masters give you a glimpse, a sampling of things to build your faith. Because a mind does not build faith without some experience. And the experiential faith is actually a good faith. Blind faith is not good. So the masters give an experience like that. And they have sometimes given experience even of such kind. And when we have an experience of such kind, it's a brief glimpse of what is there. And it cannot be held with us. It's too much. So therefore, gradually, we are back to where we are. And sometimes it takes very quickly to go back to where we are. Sometimes we can stay long. Masters have all the power. It's unbelievable who they are. They look like very ordinary people. They behave like ordinary people. They talk like ordinary people. But their power is seen when we see them inside, and the inner master can do anything, can take us. Why does it take time? Why are we taking time? If the master says you are a marked soul, you have to go back to your true home, why not take immediately at that time? Because the pattern of creation here is that we go in time and space in karmic patterns, which is laid out for the method, as a method of creating here. Masters come following that method. They come in the same form, in the same method. They therefore go slowly, steadily in time based on the same thing that is happening the rest of our life. So meditation, the discovery of our higher selves also gets regulated by the same way as other things that happen in life. Like growth takes place. Why do we grow old? Why do we age? Why do we have more memories after a while? All these things go together in the pattern which is used for the creation of a physical universe. A slightly different pattern is used for dream level. A different pattern is used for the astral level. A different pattern is used for the causal level. For example, you all have dreams. In a dream, you can be here 1 second, in Chicago second, in New York 3rd second, and looks normal. People have had this sudden change of location in dreams. Never question the dream. How is it happening? If it happened now, you'll say, what is happening now? It's terrible. How can you not be in one location? So the pattern in which dream sequences are created are different than the patterns in which the physical situations are created. We sometimes refer to them as laws of nature. These are laws of nature. A tree will not grow at once. You plant the seed, it will take time to grow. We will not grow immediately, old or young. It'll take time. Everything is based upon time and space here. But the patterns used for different levels of realities are different. So that is why the masters come here and they follow the same pattern. And that is why they can take, but they give glimpses to build our faith.
Why do you put some people to sleep during your talks?
Why do you put some people to sleep? I don't put to sleep. I would be great. I would be a very powerful guy if I can put people to sleep when I like. No, it is just that if the talk is about something other than the body, the tendency to go with those words takes us to a shift in our awareness. And the shift of awareness, withdrawal from the body for meditation, and the withdrawal of body in sleep are similar. So that is why the tendency to sleep is very strong. Sometimes, I remember, I had very hard time keeping awake in some of great master discourses. Because, and some masters, when they are explaining something which you are not fully understanding, also create some sleep. There are a lot of things masters talk about which just fly over our head. And we say, why are they telling us these things? It's better to sleep. It's a normal thing, but the masters are not bothered with that because they know that if you fall asleep, you're trying to keep alert. When you're trying to keep alert and still sleep is coming, you're still trying to keep awake, it trains you how to use your attention. It means be more attentive.
What happens when one of your initiates commits suicide?
What happens when one of your initiates commits suicide? As I mentioned earlier, suicide cuts short the life, notional life of a person, and then it has to be still lived for the remaining part. And in a physical body, for our very ignorance, we have greater ability to use free will to meditate. In other forms, it's more difficult to meditate. Therefore, what can be done in meditation, say in 3 months here, can take 30 years in that other form of life. That is why one loses the opportunity of getting full benefit of the meditation. Secondly, under the law of karma, karma functions under very strange law. Karma merely says, if you do this, that will happen. Do this. It does not really define how good or bad it is. Good and bad is determined by our mind. And what is good today may be bad tomorrow. What is bad today may be good tomorrow. Societal norms are very often defining our good and bad. Our evil is created by the mind acting on the outside influence during life. And we find that persons born in different countries have different ideas of what is good, what is bad. Similarly, in different ages, things have changed very much, what is good and bad. The pattern of karma is not with what is good or bad today. It is laid down by society. Today, suicide is considered to be an evil thing. It's evil in law, it's evil in moral codes as society prescribed. So the human being who's living through it accepts that, but yet because of other circumstances ends life, but the karma still plays, and therefore because the mind has been trained to think, yes, this is bad what you're doing, you get punished. So punishment and reward are based upon our concept of the moral code that has been laid out for us. And therefore, suicide is considered to be something that gets punished, not rewarded. So my recommendation always is, do not commit suicide. Live your full life and use it for the best meditation you can do, which you cannot do after suicide.
Who and what can help to reach the level of love necessary to rise above body consciousness after one's physical master has left their plane?
Who and what can help to reach the level of love necessary to rise above body consciousness after one's physical master has left the plane? Our relationship with a master is not a physical relationship. Once a master initiates us, from that moment, he is available to us in sight. Therefore, one should have a contact with the inner master right from the beginning of initiation. It may be a little difficult in the beginning. It may be, we may not be fully aware how to contact the master inside, but the master is there inside. That is why when a master is in physical self, one should develop the contact with the master inside. Great master told us that the best thing you can do is to have the radiant form of the master manifested in your meditation before a physical master dies. But if a physical master dies, the radiant form has not gone anywhere, it's still there. It's permanent with you. It's always be with you. That is why a physical master dies and you have done just sufficient meditation to be able to have the form of the master inside, that form will become as real as the physical master. Imagine, I was initiated 1936, long ago. Great master, his body passed away 1948. He stayed with me as alive and kicking as he was when he was alive. Masters don't die like that. Masters remain with us. So the recommendation is that instead of just blindly believing that he is with you, manifest him in your meditation. People are looking for radiant form of master. That word has been used, Nuri Swarup, radiant form. And people are interpreting what radiant form means. Maybe light is shining out of him. I've seen some people drawing pictures. Light from the feet of master coming, there's a radiant form. No, there's no sprinklers or lights coming from him. That's not called a radiant form. It's called radiant form because it can be seen in the darkness. What can be seen in the darkness is radiant. We have watches that we can see in the darkness. They're radiant also. We are radiant too. When you are sitting in a completely dark room with your eyes closed, even with some pen on your eyes, your imagination can see things. How can they see if it's totally dark? Because your imagination can create the light necessary for the object to be lit up. The darkness is not affecting. Physical objects cannot be seen if light does not fall upon them. Astral objects can be seen, imaginative objects can be seen without any light falling upon them. Therefore, all objects that we see in the astral plane are radiant forms. So the master, when he appears, we call him radiant form because he can appear and be seen even if it is dark. So that is, it doesn't mean look different. He looks the same. Okay, then how do we get the radiant form? Start by remembering the master. I'll tell you a simple way. Do not imagine a picture of the master. Do not look at a photo of the master. When you do that, it doesn't form, it does not create a radiant form. Remember the form of the master and the experience with the master when you last saw it. That means it's a memory. It's a memory to remember. You can always remember. You remember you saw the master walking, you saw the master talking. We can always remember an event like that, especially if it is not too old. If it's just a few months old, we can remember. A year old, we can remember. Beyond that, maybe a little difficult. But we can remember what the master looked like, what we saw. So start by using in meditation, closing your eyes, putting yourself third eye center. There, remember the form of the master. And the remembering of the master brings the image back. So when the memory of the master comes, that you saw him walking, and then you remember him walking again, if you are doing your meditation with attention on that, master will stop walking, turn to you, and start talking to you. That was not part of what he did when he was walking. But when you remember him walking, in the middle, he continues his life inside you as if he is now still there and talking to you. That is actually the radiant form. So it's a simple practice that don't try to force yourself to see something. Remember. The memory of a perfect living master, of his face particularly, of his eyes and forehead. If you can remember, and always remember when you see a master, try to remember the eyes and the forehead. Because no negative entity, not even your mind, can reproduce it even by imagining. You can't even imagine the eyes of a master and the forehead of a master if he's not really there. That is why, if you can remember that, and it comes back to you, the memory comes back to you, master will start being alive from that point onwards inside. So the radiant form is not that difficult to get like most people think it is. Get that experience and hold on to that experience as long as you can while a master is still alive. Then for you, you'll find the passing away of a master's physical body will never make you miss the master. You know master is already with you. So don't worry about it. The master gives always guidance from inside. If somehow you cannot do it, for any reason, work harder then. If a perfect living master who initiated you passes away and you have not established the radiant form, then work hard to get it there. It's still there. It hasn't gone anywhere. So then work hard. Put more time to meditation, more concentration, more attention, and master will appear. But don't forget that it is not the picture. It is a life form of a master. That is why they say it is so important to have a darshan. Darshan means looking at the face of a master. Darshan is very important on the spiritual path. Your connection with the master is established by looking at him. If it's drishti, which means the master looks at you with his eyes, it focuses even more. I heard an old story of Narad Muni. I might have recited earlier. There was a, you know, the rishis, munis, yogis of different categories. A certain category of achievement in enlightenment where you can become a muni, just little higher than a rishi. So rishi muni are common features in India. There was a famous muni, his name was Narad Muni. And he had practiced a lot of knowledge and he was able to manifest his God, whom he worshipped, Brahma, the creator of the universe. So he had his own image of Brahma, as he had seen in the temple. And he was able to manifest and have a conversation with Brahma. One day, Narad Muni was walking along and he saw a crowd of people running. And he asked them, "Where are you going?" They said, "There's a perfect master has come to give a discourse. We are going to have his darshan." He said, "What is darshan?" They said, "We want to look at him." What's there great about looking at a person? And he therefore went into his own meditation and manifested his ishta, his deity, his master, Brahma. He said, "Mr. Brahma, I have a problem. I saw people running to see the face of a person they call a master. What's the benefit of having a, just looking at a master, having a darshan of a master?" And Brahma said, "Oh Narad, to get the answer, you go to a particular village and there is a snake in the pond there. Ask this question from the snake and he will give you the answer." So Narad Muni traveled to that village and he saw a pond and a snake with his head up in the water. And he said, "Mr. Snake, I want to know what is the benefit of having a look at a master's face called darshan." And the snake dropped his head and died. He was very surprised. So he went into meditation again and asked, "Mr. Brahmaji, I went to the snake and asked this question. The snake dropped his head and died." "Brahmaji, I'm very sorry to hear that. Now you go to another village, a little distant away. And there is a jeweler there who just bought a parrot. And the parrot is in a cage. Go and ask this question from the parrot." So now Narad Muni traveled to the other place. And he asked, "Is there a jeweler living in this village?" They found one is living. "Okay, do we have a parrot?" "Yes, we just got a parrot. Can I ask a parrot a question?" "Oh, must be very lucky parrot. Narad Muni, you are coming to see our parrot." So he went to the parrot, said, "Mr. Parrot, what is the benefit of having darshan of a master? People are running to have darshan." And the parrot looked at him, dropped his head and died. He said, "I am not getting any answer." He went back to Brahmaji. "Brahmaji, the parrot also died." "Oh, I'm very sorry to hear that." "Brahmaji must be a very clever kind of guy, the way he talks." He said, "Now you go on a long journey. That would be another kingdom. But they know you. The king knows you. Go to the king's palace and check if his wife, the queen, has given birth to a baby boy. If she has, go and get the answer from there. Ask the baby child there." Now, parrot and snake were all right. He got a little worried about asking the question from a human baby. But it was Brahmaji's order, so he went. And after long, many months of travel, he reached that kingdom, went to the palace, and the king welcomed him. "Narad Muni, come all the way to our kingdom. We are very lucky people." He, in a very sober mood, said, "Has the queen given birth to a baby boy?" "Yes, she has, only recently. Very, very small infant is inside." "Can I ask a question from that infant?" "Yes, yes, yes, we love to see you conversing with our baby." "No, no, I want to ask alone." "Okay, you can go and see the baby." And he went and saw the little baby and he said, Mr. Baby. I'm just adding Mr. for English translation. Mr. Baby, tell me the benefit of looking at a master having darshan. Baby spoke up. Baby said, Narad, I am the same snake you saw in the pond. I am the same parrot you saw in the village. You are not a master. You are just a muni. Just by seeing you, I cut short my life of a snake and got a better life as a parrot. I had your darshan second time and cut short the life of a parrot and became a human being. This is the benefit of seeing a muni. The benefit of seeing a master is 1,000 times more. An old story told in India, but this is a story to emphasize that darshan is something very important. According to great master, every time you have darshan of a master, it cuts down, reduces your karma. It's very difficult to get rid of karma. It reduces the impact of your karma. Drishti reduces even more. So these are factors that make it possible for us. Darshan and drishti make it possible for us to manifest the radiant form of the master while he is alive. And therefore, I always recommend those who have living masters, please do so while he is alive. The master is alive. Have his darshan. One American disciple had asked, great master, Master, how often should we come and see you? We liked your darshan. How often should we come? Great master said, the best is to come every day. He said, Master, we can't come every day. We don't live here in the Dera. He said, well, if you're not living in the Dera, living outside, you can come once a week. And by the way, when this conversation took place, my grandfather, who was present there, he overheard great master saying, if you're not living in the Dera, you should come once a week. From that date till the end of his life, he went every Sunday to the Dera to see the great master. So then the American disciple said, but supposing we're living very far, can't come every day from a nearby place, we can't afford it. Great master said, then even once a month is as good as a person living here sees me every day. You come once a month is equally good. But master, supposing we are living overseas in a different country, like I am living in the United States, very far from India. He said, then once a year is as good as seeing every day. If you come once a year, the benefit is the same. And he said, master, supposing one cannot come once a year. Then great master smiled and he said, then there's a next life available. So much importance he gave to the darshan of a master. So that is why I have recommended to all my friends, please, if you have a master, please make it a point once a year at least. You don't want to wait for next life. You don't want a next life. That is why the manifesting of the radiant form will take place with more darshan, remembering the master and meditating with him, conversing with him, having conversation with the master. Don't make meditation a mechanical thing. Make it a contact with the master. Master is inside because he initiated you. Therefore, have a conversation with the master. If you can't see him on day one or day two, you will see him sooner or later. And if you see him outside more often and remember, you'll see him more often. So that is why there is nothing that is lost. If still you can't see the master and you want guidance, then seek guidance from any other master. Seek guidance from another disciple, other advanced disciple. Get guidance from other brother of yours. Get something from anybody. But the real guidance will come from inside. Well, thank you very much for listening to all my answers. Some little humorous. And I'm glad I was able to show you my reading glasses. I don't read much, you can see that. There they go back. If these glasses can fit into this, the whole universe can fit into your head. Thank you very much.